This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Animorphs, Book 40, The Other, by K.A. Applegate, read by Ramon de Ocampo. Chapter 1. Who am I? Marco. Not Tuan or Kevin or Rashid. You know, hi, I'm Marco. If you yell out, "Hey, Marco," chances are good I'll turn around. Respond, "What?" You could also say that who I am is far more than a name. That who I am depends on your perspective, on where you're standing when you yell out to me. Like, if you're standing out in the everyday world, in Red Lobster on all-you-can-eat shrimp night, on a downtown street corner, or in the mall, you'll see that I'm a slightly less than tall, brown-haired kid. Come a little closer, like into my home, and you'll see that I'm also a son, a friend, and on a very rare day, a decent dog sitter. If, however, you're standing in a very particular, very up-close and personal spot, like inside my head, you'll see that I am, in addition, a few other, less ordinary things. Defender of Earth. Civilization's last chance for survival. Stuff like that. Generally speaking, I make it a policy not to let people stand in that very up-close and personal spot. Superheroes tend to rack up a lot of dead friends and seriously damaged sidekicks. That is one reason it's not a good idea for you to know much more about me than my first name. The other reason anonymity is a good thing? The Yeerks. The Yeerks. If it weren't for Elfangor, an Andalite war prince, I wouldn't even know about the Yeerks, aliens from a far distant planet. Wouldn't have been enlisted. Me, four other kids, and another Andalite, to fight them. To try and stop their slow but constant infestation of Earth. See, Yeerks are like slugs. On their own, they're blind, deaf, and mute. But in the brain of a host body, they've got eyes and ears and mouths. They're parasites, the Yeerks, living off the minds and bodies of any creature they deem worth controlling. Geds, Hork-Bajir, humans, and one, only one, Andalite. Yeerks wriggle their way through the ear canal and into each nook and cranny of the brain. Open memories, raise hands, move legs. Once a Yeerk is in your head, you're totally and completely at its mercy, saying what it wants you to say, going where it wants you to go, listening silently as it mocks your every desire and dream, watching impotently as it enlists your mother or father or best friend into a life of slavery. The right to privacy? Gone. The privilege of freedom? Gone. What Elfangor did was give us access to Andalite morphing technology. This is our weapon, the ability to absorb through touch the DNA of a living creature, and then become that creature. We morph to fight and to infiltrate, to spy on the Yeerk cover organization, the sharing, and occasionally kick Yeerk butt. We become whatever we need to become. Elephant, or gorilla, or grizzly, tiger, or wolf, or cockroach, cheetah, or polar bear, or even Hork-Bajir. All of which makes that "who are you" question a whole lot more complicated for me than for, say, about 99.9% of folks on this planet. That remaining 0.1%, those would be my friends. The other Animorphs, Jake, Cassie, Rachel, Tobias, the guy who lives as a hawk. Ax, Elfangor's younger brother. Obviously, there are a lot of issues we have to deal with. Issues far too complex for the six of us to waste a lot of time thinking about. Or maybe we've become far too complex for them to matter too much anymore. In almost every way you can imagine, we've pretty much been there, done that, and bought the t-shirt and poster. If anyone from Guardian or Prudential knew the truth about us, we'd never ever get health insurance. Forget about life. Me and my friends, we are the definition of extreme living. We are the definition of high risk. We don't need to sign up for a class at the local community college or pay some slick shrink $150 an hour to tell us we're not realizing our potential. Our potentials have been realized up the wazoo. See, this war comes down to life or death, freedom or slavery, dignity or abject humiliation. Failure is not an option. Bottom line, we're here to serve. It's not only about us. It's about you, too. That's why, every once in a while, it's real nice to be alone. Shut out the world and do something just for me. Something totally and completely self-indulgent and soul-numbing. Something that requires almost no effort, physical or intellectual. The house was empty. Dad and Nora were at a PTA meeting. Euclid was spending the night at the vet, recovering from some minor doggy surgery. Jake and Rachel were off at a family thing. Cassie and her mom had gone to some big veterinary conference at the gardens, and I guess Ax and Tobias were doing whatever red-tailed hawks and aliens do on an off night. I just knew I was blissfully alone. I lay back on the living room couch, stretched like a lazy old cat, reached for the remote on the coffee table. Nothing good on the tube. Perfect. I channel surfed past SpongeBob SquarePants and a minor league baseball game, past two fat ladies on the Food Channel, past a documentary on Beatles. Ah, unsolved mysteries. Cool. The Loch Ness Monster. Bigfoot. Aliens from outer space. Mr. Fake Spooky Host looked wide-eyed into the camera.
When we come back, after these messages, we'll continue our in-depth investigation of legendary creatures with an amateur video made just weeks ago, right here in...
I hit the mute button and waited, hummed some Kid Rock, yawned, bit a hangnail. 7 commercials later, the show was back. And then, the world fell apart. Chapter 2. It was just a blue blur moving across the screen. Not much more than that. A small piece of videotape taken with an unsteady hand in terrible light conditions. But it was enough. My foolproof danger alarm went off, loud.
Could this be proof positive of the existence of the magical unicorn of medieval lore? The host intoned. Or could this strange blue creature be the mighty centaur of Greek mythology? Let's take another look.
I hit the power button and the screen went gray. One look had been more than enough. The image was blurred but unmistakable. Andalite. I scaled the stairs to my bedroom, 2 at a time. This was bad, really bad, a serious breach in security. The beginning of our end. A good bazillion citizens of the United States of America, and who knew how many people in how many other countries, had just gotten their first glimpse of a bona fide alien. 80, maybe 90% of those viewers would be excited for about 30 seconds, at least until the next silly monster after the next silly commercial. 10, maybe 20% of those viewers would recognize the blue blur for what it was. Not a unicorn. Or a centaur. An Andalite. Here. On Earth. And it could only be... Ax. Okay, Visser Three and every other Yeerk with a host knew of the Andalite bandits. The ones who formed the small but unrelenting resistance to the Yeerk movement. But others, humans not controlled by Yeerks, didn't know. And they couldn't, shouldn't. It was too dangerous, too risky. Bad for Ax to be taken prisoner by the Visser. worse for him to be taken for study by the government. Not everybody in the agency was as fair-minded as Scully or Mulder. Some were even Yeerks. Ax would not be taken. I would make sure of that. 1,000 fears and anxieties ran through my head almost as quickly as I ran up the steps and into my room. I had to get control, focus, maintain that focus. I went to the bed, arranged the pillows under the blankets to look like a sleeping kid, so my dad and my stepmother wouldn't know I was gone. Again. I stripped down to my morphing suit, tossed jeans, t-shirt, and sneakers into the pit that is my closet, tore open the window, and began to morph. The goal? Rapid transportation. Ping, ping. I winced. The beginning of talons, where my toes had been only a few seconds ago. I watched as the rest of my feet and ankles withered, shrunk, and suddenly became the bird's incredibly strong, gripping feet. 3 long, fleshless talons facing front, 1 facing back. No way those feet could support my thick human legs. I was going down. Thump! I was definitely down. But I'd fallen on my back. I lifted my head and watched as my legs blackened and shriveled up into my body like 2 sticks of beef jerky being sucked up by a gnarly old cowboy. Right then, I vowed never ever to eat a Slim Jim again. In spite of what you might think, morphing doesn't hurt. It's just disgusting. But still, I watched, as if I could hurry the process by witnessing it. Fingers curling into my palm, tanned human flesh lightening to gray and then disappearing under a flat, 3-dimensional tattoo of feathers. Then arms sprouting feathers in a fury. At the same time, arm bones shrinking, hollowing, reshaping, becoming wings. My mouth and nose melded together, hardened to form a curved and deadly beak. Internal organs? I felt approximately 25 feet of human intestines smush and squish down to a bird's tiny digestive tract. My slow and steady human heart surge into the manic, pulsing heart of the bird of prey. No longer human, no longer tall enough to see the unopened notebooks scattered over the desk, the handful of empty bubblegum wrappers I should probably throw away. Close enough to the carpet to see boulders of cookie crumbs and single strands of curly poodle hair. Ugh. I was an osprey, the animal that had become one of my earliest morphs. Not a bird with the greatest night vision, but vision a heck of a lot better than a human's. Vision good enough to get me where I was going. Axe's scoop. I hopped up onto the windowsill, glanced sharply around with beady eyes to be certain the house wasn't being watched, and flapped into the night air. Chapter 3. Axe was at home, and he had company perched on a nearby branch. Tobias!
What brings a guy like you to a place like this?
Nothing good. I flared my wings and landed on the soft grass and dirt. Started demorphing.
When is it ever good when one of us just shows up all unexpected? He added.
I didn't answer. Tobias has been big on rhetorical questions lately. Besides, at the moment, I didn't have any of what Axe would call mouth parts. But I did have eyes. Axe's TV was on, but not on the station I'd been watching. As soon as my lips were formed, I looked directly at Tobias, then at Axe.
Our buddy Axe here is a star, I said brightly,
brushing dried out pine needles off my bike shorts, wincing when a sharp stone bit into my tender human foot. I told them what I'd seen. When I'd finished, there was silence. It was Tobias who spoke first.
Well, Axe?
His thought speak was hoarse, almost anxious.
Is it possible?
Axe hesitated, turned his main stalk eyes to look behind him toward the deeper woods.
Anything is possible, he said.
That was not what I wanted to hear.
I guess we need to get a copy of that episode, Tobias said.
Do you think, really? I said, rolling my eyes. Okay, listen, we don't have time to wait around for the rerun or to send a check to the station in order to buy a copy. We just can't risk waiting.
That's true, Ax said as he stepped to his television setup. But we don't have to wait.
Did I miss something? Because I'm definitely not understanding you.
Ax tapes everything, Tobias explained, on every channel. He's set up a CD-ROM thing to the VCR or something like that. Anyway, it works.
Marco, I believe this is what you are looking for.
Ax stepped back from his small pile of equipment. With a remote, he fast-forwarded through the 30-minute show until he reached the segment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.